welcome to episode 7 of Wool in the Wardrobe. To new viewers, thanks so much for checking out my podcast. And to returning viewers, thanks so much for coming back and talking about some knitting, spinning, and hand-dyeing yarn with me. My name is Kelsey, otherwise known as Primrose Yarn Co. on Ravelry and Instagram. Where I'm most active is on Instagram, so if you want to know anything that's going on with Primrose Yarn Co., you can check me out there. That's where I do a lot of the posts, and I do a lot of updates and show updates and everything on Ravelry and on Instagram. So, guys, if you're not part of the Primrose Yarn Co. group, go check it out. And also, we have a group for Wool in the Wardrobe podcast, where you can find everything out about the knit-alongs we have going on, the prizes that are available for the knit-alongs, and the same goes for Primrose Yarn Co. So, without further ado, let's get to the podcast. I'm going to go through some admin stuff. I'm going to talk about some FOs, some works in progresses. I have an Ask Me Anything question, and I'm pretty excited about that because it pertains to hand-dyeing yarn and a couple of questions that I'm frequently asked about hand-dyeing. And then we're going to go into stash enhancement, shop updates, and finally we're going to talk about leather. Well, good. I got through. This is like the 12th time I had to record the intro, and I swear every time it gets a little bit easier, but it's still the most difficult part of the podcast. But anyway, I wanted to make an admin announcement that we are having a Primrose Shawl Along, which goes until the end of the year, so January 1st at 12:01 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. I will be closing the threads. There will be many prizes available, and all of the information and the rules pertaining to that specific knit along can be found in the Wool in the Wardrobe podcast and mostly on the Primrose Yarn Co. page on Ravelry, but you can also find some information out on the Wool in the Wardrobe podcast page. So I think that's pretty much it for admin stuff. My first FO, unfortunately, I won't be able to show you. It is outside blocking. This is the first day we've actually had really, really nice weather. So I put my mom's Rhinebeck sweater, which I finished yesterday. I soaked it and then I put it on blocking mats to block. And it is outside right now drying. So next podcast, I will show you that. Unless it interferes with us traveling to Rhinebeck, I will be doing some podcasting from Rhinebeck, but I will be able to show you that. Little information about it. It is the Vera Valimaki, I think is how you pronounce her name. It's one of her patterns, and it was done in a discontinued base. I needed to get rid of some bulky yarn that I had sitting around in the shop. So I dyed up a custom colorway for my mom, and it's called Mum, and it will be available in most of my bases at Rhinebeck. So when I do show the finished object, you will be able to purchase the yarn. It will not be discontinued, and it is not a one-of-a-kind colorway just for my mom. So it will be a regular in the shop. The second one I wanted to talk to you guys about is my Caledonia. I finally finished this. I'm not going to take it off because it's a pain in the butt to put back on, but it is a long crescent-shaped shawl. And you can see the beautiful lace border. Maybe I will take it off. There's a beautiful lace panel at the bottom, and all the body is done in stockinette. It's not a massive shawl, but it's decent size. So I don't know if you can see. I mean, I can't get it all on, but. So that's the Caledonia. It's a pretty, pretty popular pattern on Ravelry. And it is a Kirsten Kapoor. And I did this shawl in my yarn in the Cosmic Helix space, and I did it in the colorways Angry Ocean, Rosy Thorns, and Snow Owl. So that is something that will be a sample knit that I will have hanging up at shows. It's beautiful. It's a great pattern. I would have to say it's like intermediate beginner, just because of the lace. A lot of people shy away from lace, which it's not really that difficult. See, I'm already having problems with it. It's not really that difficult to knit lace. I think what people see is the complexity of the appearance of lace, and they're like, oh, I can never do that. Really, honestly, this is just purl and knit stitches in a sequence. She does give you a chart, but she also gives you written out lace instructions, which is really nice because for me, I like to follow written out rather than chart. I think it's a little bit easier because I can count how many repeats I'm doing, as I do put stitch markers in at each repeat just so that I can tell where I'm at. So if I make a mistake, I can see that it's in that section and I don't have to rip back entire rows. I'm not a lifeline person either, so I don't like having to put lifelines in. So putting in stitch markers at every repeat also helped me knit this pattern and knit really fast. I think this took me 3 days to knit. So this was a finished object a while ago. I don't think I did share it on the podcast, but I did really like it. I like a lot of her patterns that she has available on Ravelry. This is a purchase pattern, just to let you guys know. But unfortunately, that's all I have for FOs right now. I'm really being monogamous on my dad's Rhinebeck sweater, which I will be able to show you guys. Give me 1 second. Sorry, I'm shaking the camera. It's on an uneasy table. So, goodness. This is my dad's Rhinebeck sweater, and this is what I have so far. It is the Gramps cardigan by Tin Can Knits. So I've done both of the sleeves here, as you can see. I've not woven in the ends, which I am going to do today. All that's left to do is pick up and knit the button band that goes all the way around. And this is the fourth time, I think I did say this on the last episode, this is the fourth time I've knit this pattern. And I love this pattern so much because it's so universal. It's a unisex pattern. Yeah, it's a unisex pattern. So men and women can wear it. I knit one for my daughter, one for my husband, and one for myself. And it really does look great on everybody. So if you're looking for just a plain stockinette sweater, I recommend highly this pattern by Tin Can Knits. It is the top down. As you can see, the sleeves are built in. And then you go back and you pick up the sleeves and you just knit stockinette, doing decreases as you go. Again, another paid for pattern available on Ravelry. What else can I say? This actually is a worsted weight sweater. I knit my daughter's in a DK and I knit my husband's in worsted and I knit mine in Aran. I do like the worsted version the best. I do think she did pair it well with the weight of yarn that she chose to knit it in. This is a custom colorway for my dad, but again, will be available in the shop as a regular. This colorway is called Papaw, which is what my daughter calls my dad. And yeah, I really like it. This is going to be like a crazy big collar and button band to do though, because my dad is a very tall man. So he's 6'1". So it's going to be intense, but I'm feeling a little bit less pressured to get it done because I just finished my mom's the other day, and I know if a lot of you follow me on Instagram, you'll know that this year I decided to knit my entire family Rhinebeck sweaters. Basically what that meant was I had to knit my parents 2 Rhinebeck sweaters, and then I had to finish mine. Yeah. So I'm cutting it a little bit closer considering the times that I cast both of them on than I probably would have liked, but I'm getting them done, you guys. So yay me. I mean, right? It's a good thing. I will have it done for Rhinebeck, no doubt, but I'm finding when I give myself obligations in knitting, it really frustrates me when it comes to my selfish knitting for myself, because I really, really, really want to be working on my calligraphy cardigan by Hannah Fettig. And I thought I might be going to Rhinebeck with 2 sweaters this year. It's not going to happen. I've made much progress. I will show you guys how much progress I've made since we last talked. So last time I showed you guys this, I had only just, I was just about to separate this for the sleeves, I think. And I've only done about that much. Now, granted, this is a DK weight sweater. I love how it's turning out. Let me turn it around so you guys can see. So it's a top down and you cast on with part of the collar. So you cast up on here. You do part of the collar. And then you start working the body. And it almost kind of reminds me of the Grimms cardigan because minus some of the structural stuff, it, you know, you don't cast on any of the collar for the Grimms cardigan, but it's same. It's set in sleeves, not set in sleeves. I can't talk today, guys. I'm sorry. It's been a long week so far, and it's only Tuesday. You have your worked sleeves. So since it's top down, the sleeves are knit at the same time as the body, and then you'll go back and you'll pick up the sleeves. And then the difference between the Gramps cardigan and the calligraphy cardigan by Hannah Fettig is that instead of having to start at the bottom on one side and knit all the way up and around, you knit the button bands in two separate sections. So you're actually going all the way up where I had the collar, and you're going to work all the way up to the corners of each side of the collar, and you just work back and forth, which I'm probably going to like that feature a little bit better, because I do feel when I knit the Gramps cardigan that it just feels like so much knitting, and it's I don't want to say it's deterring me from wanting to finish my dad's, but it's also really like you have to move it a lot and really like move the, I don't know, just pick it up and shift it all the time. Whereas I feel like when I'm knitting the calligraphy, I can just switch sides back and forth. And I'll be knitting one like panel that's going to be about that wide by about that long. So I feel like it won't be as bad, and it won't feel as like heavy and as frumpy when I'm working with it, which is something I'm looking forward to. I do actually think, unlike most of my sweaters, like I didn't put in button band or official button bands for the Exeter. I didn't put in buttons for my my personal Gramps cardigan by Tin Can Knits. I think those are the only two that I didn't actually utilize buttons. I like open sweaters a lot more than I do the closed ones that use buttons. So I mean, I never use buttons, so I never put them in. I never take the time to actually build in buttons, buttonholes and stuff like that, so that I can actually close them. I just don't use them, so I just don't knit them. I think that's all I wanted to say about the calligraphy and the Tin Can Knit sweater. But if you do happen to see my dad walking around at Rhinebeck, you know, say hey. My parents are cool. They love, he thought it was awesome. He was at a Penn State football game, and one of the husbands that he went with said his wife recognized my name, and he thought that was just crazy awesome. So, yeah, so they know, like, they're all about what I do. They love to hear about, you know, how you guys think about the yarn that I dye, and so it's pretty cool that my parents are so supportive. But the next thing I wanted to talk to you guys about, which unfortunately I haven't touched, because most of these things I'm going to say, I haven't touched it because I've been knitting monogamously on my dad's, is my Boardwalk Shawl by Stephen West. And you can see I've like knit literally six rows maybe since we last talked, but there it is in all its glory. And I will link my project. If you guys want to know what colorways I'm using, I will link all that in my show notes, which, by the way, I forgot to mention, you can find on the Wool in the Wardrobe podcast page on Ravelry. if you haven't joined it, please, please do. I keep you guys informed about knit-alongs on that group page, and I keep all of my show, like events that I'm vending at, and all of my shop update information you can find on the Primrose Yarn Co. page on Ravelry. So please, if you guys haven't joined them, please do. Anyway, my last work in progress I wanted to show you guys. Oh, and by the way, the boardwalk shawl is in fingering weight in my Cosmic Helix base. It's a new base that I'm introducing. No shop has it right now, so the first people that will get a chance to buy it, they were at Stitches, Chicago, and now I'm going to be taking it to Rhinebeck. So you guys will have an opportunity to get some new bases. So I was watching the Inside Number 23 podcast with Katie, and she made me want to knit. I know I said I was never. And everybody who like has been following me and knows I had no interest in doing a Cozy Memories blanket. There is nothing appealing to me about knitting a fingering weight blanket. I mean, could you imagine how many fingering weight sweaters you could get out of the time that you spend knitting a Cozy Memories blanket? Just think about that in your head real quick. Probably three. But I did. I knit one on. I cast one on. I know. I can hear you guys laughing at me. But I had to. So here's what I have so far, and I do have one that I'm working on. And I try, I was trying to do one a night. Like, my husband and I normally go up around, like, 12 a.m. So I normally try to crank one out in, like, 25, 30 minutes every night while we're sitting and watching, like, a last-minute TV show or, you know, just chatting or whatever we do. And I haven't been that successful. So I only have four finished ones. I do have one work in progress. And these are on size US 2s, so they're 2.75s, and they're on, I actually ordered on Amazon Prime some carbons. Because I really am liking how I'm, like, the carbons work when I'm knitting on my calligraphy cardigan. So I thought, rather than do, and I'm like, I'm not a big double point person at all, but because it's such, they're so small, they fit on perfectly, and I can zoom through, as opposed to, like, having to slide the needle with an circulars. I really am liking actually just knitting on these double points. So I got these specifically to knit this blanket. The nice thing about it, too, is if I get tired of knitting on one, there's three other needles, and I can just, like, pick something else up. And, of course, I wouldn't do that, though, because that would, like, why would I, you know? Kind of, like, that I have that option because it only takes two needles. So I have this going. I have a whole bunch of minis in here. You know, like, I know I'm supposed to be, like, using stuff that I've worked with projects. I'm really having a hard time talking today, and I don't know why. But, I mean, like, I bought a whole bunch of Madeline Tosh unicorn tails, and actually I can probably get two squares out of each because I think they only take, like, how many grams is this? No, it doesn't say. That's nice. Well, it does say 52 yards. I don't think they actually take more than maybe 20 yards each. I'm not doing the regular Cozy Memories blanket. I did actually cast on the Coziest Memories blanket by Kemper Ray. I think that's how you pronounce her last name. W-R-A-Y. And that's the one that Katie from Inside Number 23 actually said that she's using that pattern, and she likes it because all the squares are built in and you don't have to go back and seam them in. I'm not sure. I didn't really look at the pattern for Cozy Memories blanket, but I'm really liking how fast it goes. You just pick up, knit. It's a free pattern, so I don't think it's going to be a big deal if I give it away. You pick up, you're doing like 13 on one side. So if you like imagine the one corner, it's 13 stitches here, or 23 stitches, sorry. 23 stitches here and 23 stitches here. And then when you finish a square, you go back and you pick up 23, you put a stitch marker in and you cast on 23 more. And that's just for the bottom. The tops will change. I'm sure you're gonna, like for the side, you're gonna cast on 23 and then you're going to pick up on the bottom and then you're gonna pick up on the side of that when you have like an L shape. So when you start your next row, you're just gonna be picking up and building from that point. I like that feature because then I'm not stuck with all these squares that I have to sew together at the end. I'm not a big sewing person. I don't mind it when I have to do sweaters, but if I had to sew together 160 squares, I'd probably lose my mind and say, yeah, I was right. I'm never going to knit a Cozy Memories blanket. But so, haha, hypocrite. I know. What are you going to do? Next, I want to move along to Ask Me Anything. I'm really excited. It pertains to dyeing, so it's a question that I commonly get from people who meet me at shows, who sometimes just have questions on Instagram or on Ravelry, and they want to know what is the difference. Oh, this question came from Crafty Kimmy Knits on Instagram, and she said, what's the difference or downside to dyeing with non-superwash wool? And what's it like dyeing with non-superwash wool? And she told me, I actually had a nice chat with her on the phone because this is easier to explain. It's lengthy, so it's easier for me to explain on the phone rather than like write everything out. Because there's a couple things. So for those of you who don't know, fiber, animal fiber mainly, has barbs. Like if you look at it under a microscope, you have the main shaft of the fiber, but there are like barbs that stick out and it almost looks like the trunk of a palm tree. And when it goes through the superwash process, those barbs are stripped off the fiber so that you just have a smooth shaft. And the barbs are actually what create the interlocking during the felting process. That's what makes the fibers lock together and stay together. Well, when wool mills that are making non-superwash wool or superwash get their wool before it's, you know, it's been processed and stuff, typically they're getting non-coated, non-skirted. It's like I don't want to say it's the bottom of the barrel because I don't want to downplay like any kind of like fiber, you know, it's important, but they're not going to get the top end fiber. So what they do is they send it through a wash process, but it's not a real thorough wash process, which is why a lot of non-superwash wool pretty much still smells like sheep. That lanolin is still there. When she was saying, her main question was, when I dye my yarn non-superwash, why don't dyes take like they do with superwash? Well, my response to that was the lanolin almost acts as a resist on a lot of the non-superwash, which is why a lot of the vibrant colors that you get with superwash don't really appear as vibrant on non-superwash. So if you imagine, I don't know if any of you have done silk painting, but you normally put down a wax or some kind of water resist onto silk. You can draw lines and paint in like a paint by number kind of a thing. But that wax kind of stops that dye from going any further. When you get non-superwash wool, it still has that lanolin, which is a waxy coated substance. It's not a lot of lanolin, but it's enough that kind of resists the dyes as opposed to superwash. Superwash has gone through a chemical process to strip the barbs off of the fiber so that you have a non-interlocking fiber that will not felt. That chemical process that it goes through has stripped almost all of the lanolin out of it, out of all of the yarn. So there you go. You don't have that resist from the lanolin in superwash wool as opposed to non-superwash, which still has not a lot of lanolin, but it has a lot more than, I mean, it's almost non-existent in superwash, but with non-superwash wool, you have very little, or you have a lot of, now I'm getting this backwards, sorry. Okay, so start again. Superwash wool has very little, if any, lanolin in it, which doesn't act as a resist because it's not there. Non-superwash wool has lanolin in it. There's a lot more than most people would think. It acts as a resist against the dye. Colors won't be as bright. They won't accept as much dye because the dye only will stick to the fiber. That's what acid dyeing is. It sticks to the fiber. It will not stick to many, many other things. I mean, you can dye your clothes by accident, but that's a fiber. If you get some on your countertop, that's not a fiber. It's not meant to be dyed. So that's why when I'm dyeing and if I splash some dye on, you know, my countertop, I can just wipe it down with some bleach and it cleans it right up. Whereas opposed to when you're dyeing fiber itself, that acid is made specifically, that acid dye is chemically adhered to specifically take to the fiber. So all in all, there are a couple solutions that you can do if you have non-superwash, if you have regular wool yarn. You can basically do what you would do with a fleece that you need to wash, which you could take some dish soap or some nice laundry detergent, boil some water, turn off your stove, keep the water really hot. Have your yarn already pre-soaking in water so that you don't have to fiddle with it and make it damp in the dye pot. Because when you add friction to wool that hasn't gone through the superwash process, you can have problems with felting. So you want your yarn to already be damp. You add it to the hot water, you squirt on the soap, just agitate a little bit so that that soap gets on all the surfaces. Do not be too thorough when you are adding the soap into that pot because you are going to felt your yarn. I guarantee it. Then what you can do is have a tub or, you know, like a sink or a basin or something that you can, with like medium warm water, not cold, because that temperature change can also felt your yarn. Have pretty warm water, but clean with no soap in it. Take your yarn from that bath that you've just done with either the dish soap or the regular laundry detergent, whatever. It has to kind of be a soft, like, so use the soft hand soap, you know, or, you know, hand whatever. And then hand soft laundry detergent as well, you know. So maybe baby laundry detergent. And that's what you actually want to use when you don't want to use like hard, you know, cut grease and grime kind of stuff. You actually want it to be a softer soap because bad things happen, trust me. And then take it out of that pot, put it in that basin of clean water, and just move the yarn so that it can open up and release all that soap. What you've just done is pretty much, with the hot water and the soap bath, you've melted off the lanolin. Because what do you use when you want to strip a grease or an oil off of something? You use soap. You use some kind of counteractive product to remove this, you know, grease. That's basically what you're doing. I mean, like, think about when you wash your hair. What are you doing? You're removing the grease from your hair. You use the soap. You're basically doing the same thing. Lanolin is a natural forming grease on sheep. So that, you know, protects their skin and also protects the fleece itself. You might have to do it once or twice to get a lot of the lanolin out, but I can guarantee you that you'll probably start to see a difference if you do it at least twice. But let the yarn cool down a little bit before you go and you put it back, just a little bit, not a lot, because you don't, again, the major temperature changes are where you really start to see felting. And then the agitation on top of it, like the temperature change and the agitation, creates the felting process. So you really don't want to over agitate and you don't want to overcool your yarn. It's kind of a balance. You really got to maintain that balance. I would do it with one skein of yarn that you're not really concerned about. I hope it would be a cheaper skein, not like pretty expensive. Give it a go with one and see how it does. If that process works for you, you found a solution. Now that is an added step. That's an added step that a lot of most dyers don't go through, which is why most of us don't work with non-superwash wool. It is a pain in the butt. It adds time to our already lengthy process of dyeing yarn. So, long story short, is there a downside? Yeah, it's a longer process. You can't reliably say that one supplier versus another will give you yarn that's been thoroughly cleaned. I mean, you can still smell the lanolin and the sheep's milk on that wool. Are you going to be able to tell which, you know, yarn providers do thoroughly wash their yarn? Probably not. I mean, honestly, my best bet, even though a lot of people, like I've been hearing a lot more and more, I want to just work with regular wool. There is nothing wrong with that. That's fine. Just understand, the dye will not be as vibrant. That's another downside. It's just a fact. And with the color craze as it is right now, with speckles and with vibrant colors that people want to knit with, a lot of people are finding that superwash or silk even. Silk has like no oil in it, so silk takes great with dye. A lot of people are like, I just don't want to dye non-superwash wool. If you want to take on that challenge, more power to you. Another question she asked me was, would I be willing to do a dye demo? I will be doing a dye demo. I will be doing a setup and takedown process during that, and I will show you. I had a friend a couple of weeks ago who wanted to get into dyeing, and I was talking to her when she was getting dinner ready. And I asked her what she was up to, and she said that she had just finished dyeing and she was cleaning out the dye pot because she was about to make stew, and I almost had a heart attack. You cannot, please dear God in heaven, do not ever use dye pots for food. It is so toxic. There are all actually warning labels on acid dyes, or a lot of people will put warning labels on their acid dyes. If you're pregnant, you shouldn't be using dyes at all, because it is that toxic in powder form that, and even in wet form, like, you should not be eating out of a pot that you have used to dye yarn. So if you're interested in getting into dyeing, go to Walmart, buy a cheap stainless steel pot, and use that specifically and only for dyeing, because you can poison your family if you try to make your dinner in the dye pot that you're using to dye your yarn. So I will show you guys the setup and the takedown process for me. And I will also show you a couple. I will show you dip dyes. I will show you low submersion. And I will show you full submersion dyeing. There are many ways to dye. I don't do self-striping anymore. I don't plan to do a video on how to do self-striping, just because it is so time-consuming to do that. Honestly, I enjoy speckle dyeing a lot more. I enjoy multiple dye baths where I, you know, put one color in, let it set, take the yarn out, add another color, put the yarn back in. So it's like a dip dye, multiple dye bath kind of dye process. So I'll be doing a couple of those. I don't know how soon I can have that up, because like I said, I am getting ready for Rhinebeck, and that is my priority right now. But in the future, I will be doing that. If there's anything you guys specifically want to see me do on the podcast when I do the dye demos, please comment below or go to the Wool in the Wardrobe podcast page. I will open up a different thread from the Ask Me Anything thread. I'll open up a dye questions thread. And you guys can ask me anything you want me to show, like say, I want to see how you do this, or I want to see like this process or whatever. And then I will put that on the episodes that I do the dyeing techniques on. That is the Ask Me Anything question that I've gotten. I really love answering your questions. So if you guys have anything specific that you would like me to address on future podcasts, please feel free to ask in the Ask Me Anything thread on the group page in Ravelry, and I will do that. Most of the time I do respond to your questions directly on Ravelry. And if I feel like they pertain to a lot of people, I'll address them on the podcast as well. With that being said, stash enhancements, you guys. I'm so excited. This is like going to be the most epic stash enhancement that I've ever done, probably. So the first one I want to talk about. I got myself a fringe bag. There's the logo. And I actually got this from, I got the black one because it won't show dirt. And my favorite color is like black and pink. So I had to get the black one. I got this from Fancy Tiger Crafts and they have an online shop. And the lovely ladies, if I can find it. The lovely ladies from Fancy Tiger sent me some adorable extras. Oh goodness. Where did it go? Did I lose it already? Oh, found it. So they sent me this really, really cute Fancy Tiger Craft pin. And then they also sent me another one. They'll be going on the field bag. They're so cute. And I love the color. I'm into the, I think, who is it? Plucky has this colorway called Vintage or something like that. And it's this like beautiful sea foam green, sea misty green. And I just love the color. So yeah, they'll be going on my field bag later. And I do find they actually look a lot smaller, or they look a lot bigger on the website than they actually are. I mean, this is a pretty decent sized bag, but when I'm knitting with like, I have like six colors in here. I have six full cakes of yarn and it's just, you can see just barely fitting into the top. I do love the construction of this bag though. It is just so strong. It's like, it's cotton canvas. And it has this leather strap to hold. And it's just a really sturdy bag. They are a little bit pricey. I got mine for $65. And I do think that they offer free shipping on over $100. But I had like nothing else that I wanted to buy. So I paid like $6 to ship. So it was like a $71 bag at the end of the day. With the shipping included. But it is, I love them. And I've been watching people get them for like the past couple of months, and I was like, I can't do it anymore. I can't sit here and watch people have these bags. I need one. So I got one and I love it and it's gorgeous and I'm happy. And that's what's important. And I'm sorry, my table keeps shaking. It's not sturdy. Excuse the shakies. Next thing I got. So I peruse Ravelry all the time. Who knows? I may be stalking you. Just kidding. That sounded so creepy. I'm totally joking. I stalk stashes. Okay. So when I said on, Instagram that as soon as I'm done my calligraphy cardigan, I'm like on cast on all the sweaters. So I need a new sweater to cast on, you guys. And I found one. It is the Vera cardigan by Michelle Wong. Again, another Michelle. I have two Michelle Wong patterns, by the way, you guys. Like, I am on a Michelle Wong kick. If you're not familiar with her, please check her out. She designs for Brooklyn Tweed, and she's an independent designer for Plucky. And so some lady had these gorgeous skeins of gumshoe on a D-stash. I got seven for $80. That's almost $10 a skein. How awesome, right? It's like 11 and some change, but I mean, whatever. That's ridiculous. These skeins, they sell for like, how much are they? $26, I think, on one Plucky's site. And Plucky doesn't wholesale, I don't think, so you can't get them anywhere else. I got seven for $80. And this is going to be my Verdia. It was designed in Plucky for Plucky by Michelle. So I got the trusty, it's a DK sweater, by the way, the trusty base, and it's 250 yards and it's 100% superwash merino. So I'm really looking forward. This is going to be my next cast on, by the way. So I'm really looking forward to that. I might have like two cast ons at once. Depends. We'll see. I mean, right now I'm on like a sweater kick. All I want to do is knit sweaters. So we'll see. Next thing I got was for my Maxfield cardigan. Again, one of these was a de-stash. Actually, I take that back. Half of this one color was a de-stash. The full other color I got on simplysock.com. So this is a discontinued colorway, and I fell in love with it as soon as I saw it, and I like stocked all of the stash de-stashes. It's called Nebula, and it's a Madeline Tosh colorway. I'm hoping the camera picks this color up right. See the tag, Madeline Tosh, and it is their Tosh DK, which is 100% superwash merino wool. It's 225 yards, and yeah. So I have now 7 of them. I found 4 on a de-stash, and unfortunately enough for me, I like, when I am on a mission to find yarn, I go through every website possible. I was even willing to order from Europe to get this colorway. That's how bad I wanted it. But I found some on Webs. You know, go figure. I got the last 3 skeins on Webs, and then a lady on Ravelry was de-stashing 4. So I have enough to definitely knit this colorway. And the Maxfield, I don't know if you're familiar, and if I can figure out how to insert photos into my videos, I will insert photos of each that I'm talking about while I'm talking about them. It's like a chevron pattern panel here, and then chevrons on the sides and like some of the arms and stuff. And it's by Amy Christophers. And then I'm gonna pair it with the Electric Rainbow by Madeline Tosh. I think these colors look so nice together. What do you guys think? I really like this colorway. It's a brand new one by Madeline Tosh. And again, this is in their Tosh DK. So she hasn't changed. She just changed her labels, I think. But 225 yards again. And I'm really like, I just love, I'm excited because most of this skein is like greens and yellows and blues. So I'm really excited to see how it will pair with that. The main body color will be this. So it's going to be a dark cardigan, again, because it's all I knit. Go goth style. And then this will, it's almost like one row of color, and then you do like 2 or 3 rows of the main body color, and then you go and you do another row. So I'm really looking forward to seeing how these pair together. I did contemplate, I posted a photo on Instagram, and I got really positive feedback from you guys. It's a new colorway I called Emerald Midnight. And it's a little bit darker than this. And it's got a little bit more, I want to say like a bright sea misty aqua green in it. But a lot of dark in spots. But I feel like this, I probably won't have to alternate skeins with this one. I mean, obviously I'm not going to alternate skeins because it's striped, so you never have more than one row or 2 rows, you know, so you won't be able to really tell. But I don't think on the top portion of the body that I'll have to alternate because I got very similar dye lots from the 2 places that I got the yarn from. So they look very similar, and I know that I'll have to alternate if I use my yarn because that's just how I dyed him. I need more. You need to dye more, Madeline Tosh. Please, 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 please dye Nebula more. Please. This is a gorgeous colorway. love it. I love everything about that colorway. And I don't like blue or green. Go figure. And then, like, two colorways of Madeline's Hosh wasn't enough. Oh, yes. I got more. So, Jimmy Beans, it was the only place that I could find the quantity that I needed. And I'm not real thrilled with their shipping because it took me a week and a half to get this yarn. I like Jimmy Beans. I like their selection. I like that they have custom colorways by some of my favorite designer dyers, like Madeline Tosh. But the wait for this yarn was killing me. And you know how like eager you are to get the stuff that you buy? Well, like a week and a half is like a lifetime when you need your purchase. This beautiful, stunning, gorgeous, absolutely spectacular, perfect colorway is called Duchess. It is in the Tosh Vintage, so it is a worsted weight. And that is 200 yards, and I got 12 of them. Right. This is going to be my row cardigan by Michelle Wong, and I said I'm on a Michelle Wong kick. I wasn't kidding. This cardigan is more cable intensive than my Exeter. But it has a tubular cast on, which I'm super excited to try. So I got this beautiful color. And the sample knit that they had was in a dark, dark gray. But I'm like, I love burgundies. I love purpley, plum, deep, dark, almost black colors. So I got this one. I love it. And I'm excited. Yay. So 12 of these. 12. 12. That's 2,400 yards. That's insane. But I got it, and I needed it, so I got it. And the last stash enhancement I have isn't yarn or fiber or anything knitting related other than the fact that it stores my yarn right behind me. I drove myself down to IKEA in Baltimore, Maryland, because it's only about 50 minutes away from me, and I got the Calyx. I got two of them. On Instagram, you can see that I got one for the downstairs in the family room, which I've stashed with all of my whips, you know, some hand spun, project bags, fiber, tools for, you know, processing fiber. What else do I have? Books. My Funko Pops, because my husband and I like them. And it's the nerd in me, so that's okay. But I got the dark black one for downstairs because it matches our family room, and I wanted a more neutral tone for up here, so I got this beautiful I think it's called like oak or something like that, but I got that for up here. And so everything you see behind me is available in the shop, minus like one or two items which will be going up this week. By the time you guys see this, I will probably have made a here's what I'm doing my shop update announcement. So that's really all I have for stash enhancement. That's really like all I have. Like I didn't just show you like five things. But now we're going to move on to shop update and blather. So if you do not want to stick around, I totally understand. Thank you so much for joining me for the podcast. I hope you guys enjoy it and you come back and talk more knitting and spinning and hand dyeing. And hopefully I will have some spinning soon. I do have a loop bump on the wheel that I'm spinning up in single fingering weight. But if you want to stick around, we'll talk about shop update, which I have no idea when I'm going to do. Probably will be, let's say Thursday. I can do Thursday. So my first shop update, I have, these are reserves. Actually, I am going to make it Thursday. You know what, guys? I'm going to make it Thursday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So 7 o'clock Thursday, that will be the 29th of, am I right? Let me check. Yes, the 29th of September at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, I will be doing a shop update. And for those of you who want new colorways, I have them coming. I have a couple reserve of my old vases that I don't carry anymore that were just lying around undyed. So I threw them in the dye pot today and I dyed Emerald Midnight, I dyed Cheap Thrills, and I dyed a new one that I just talked about yesterday on Instagram. It is called Zipline. Like, I can't think of my own colorways. So sad. But I do have these, and these I don't carry anymore either, so once they're gone, they're gone. Sock blanks. So pretty. And they're long. They're 463 yards. It's 75/25 superwash and nylon. And it was called my zigzag base, my zigzag sock. But again, I don't carry them, but they will be available for purchase. And they are $30 each. So I have a bunch of them. So you guys should check them out. And what else do I have for you guys? And here's like a couple more, just so you know that I'm not just dyeing pink. I have like a blue. And I'll take pictures of the full thing so you can see them. I won't just take like small pictures, but I have like a blue one. And I have like a burnt orangey, red, pink, yellow. And I have like a green. So those will be going up on Thursday. And the next thing I have are Halloween bags. And these are big. I mean, like, I could fit my head in here, but I'm not going to do that. They're big. And it's pretty, pretty nice neutral color. Not neutral, but, like, you know, it doesn't have any patterning on it. For some of them, they do, but for this one, no. And the bigger ones are going to be 45. And they do have flat bottoms, so they can sit up. And they fit a whole sweater for the bigger ones. This one specifically is, I think, the medium. And then I have a small one to compare. And some of them have zipper pulls, and then the ones that don't, I will be attaching progress keepers on too. So you guys will be getting something on the zip pull, for a zip pull. Because I know people like that kind of stuff, and I didn't make enough zipper pulls for all of the bags that I made. And then I have this one, and then I have a bunch of these. How awesome is that fabric? It's called Monster Races, and I just love it. I think it's awesome. The Monster Races one will be 35. Okay. Trying to think if I want to talk to you guys about anything else for that specifically. I think that's it, other than I did want to throw out, people have been asking me, when are you going to be doing a shop update after you get back from Rhinebeck? The answer to that is I have no idea, because I don't really know how much inventory I will be coming back with. Hopefully none, but that hasn't happened yet. So I'm hoping that I can do a shop update like a week or two after Rhinebeck, at least a small one, but we are staying for a family vacation a little bit into the following week after Rhinebeck is concluded, and I will be coming back midweek. And I will have a lot of things to do. Like, I have to go through my inventory and do inventory counts. And I have to return a trailer. And I just have a lot of stuff on my plate when I get back. Getting back from shows is a lot more stressful than it sounds. You have a lot of maintenance stuff to do. So I will make an announcement. I will definitely have podcasted before then. So I can give you guys, I hope to podcast the night that Rhinebeck ends, and then I'll have it up for Monday, and then you guys will know. That's what my goal is, because I would like to do a podcast before Rhinebeck starts from where we're staying, which is absolutely gorgeous. I cannot wait to have that gorgeous backdrop to show you guys. It's like a converted barn, lofted barn, that was converted into a 6-bedroom house, and it is amazing. I'm so excited about it. But hopefully, and I'm really hoping that this can happen. I haven't mentioned it to them yet, but I'm hoping that they agree. On Friday, the Friday before Rhinebeck, Jenny and Devin from Handmade and Woolen and I are going to meet up, and we're going to go to a farm. And I'm hoping that we can sit down and do kind of like an impromptu podcast just to get, like, talk about, like, you know, they're starting a magazine for men's knitwear and people who knit for them, which I'm really excited about because there needs to be more things like that. I think because women are the primary focus for knitting, because we are the primary people doing it, and also we are selfish people. We like to knit for ourselves. I think that it would be wonderful to actually have a magazine that focuses on men and the men in our lives, because then I don't have to knit my husband the same sweater 15 times over. So I'm really excited about their magazine that they have coming out. And but anyway, I'm meeting up with them at a local farm that's about 45 minutes away from Poughkeepsie. And I hope we can sit down and we can chat and we can discuss the magazine a little bit for you guys, and we can discuss what they're up to and maybe talk about what I'm doing. And it would just be cool to actually do a podcast with another podcaster, because it doesn't happen very much. And then I bend at Rhinebeck. I think I will be going and visiting at the Indian Triangle Trunk Show. So if you see me, please do say hi. I really want to go visit a store called Yarn Culture that carries my yarn, and they've been so great to me. I've vended twice with them already at some Stitches shows, and Patty and her husband are wonderful. So it would be really nice to get out and say hi. And I think Christine from Skinny Dipping Yarn will be vending at the Indian Tangled Show, and I would really like to say hi to her as well. I think that's about it for Rhinebeck. I will let you guys know as soon as I have like a solid plan on when I'm going to be doing an update for all the new bases. I know people have been asking for sweater quantity stuff. I would love to sell it to you, really, but it's already been boxed up and it's packed away in a warehouse and not here. I can't get to it. So, I mean, I can, but it, you know, I can, but it's going to Rhinebeck. I'm not saying that you guys aren't worthy of the yarn that I have on hand. I just bought enough yarn that I know that I can fill my entire booth twice over. And then when I come back, I will be re-dyeing everything that I took to Rhinebeck. So no worries, I will have the exact stuff. It just might take me a little bit longer to get it up on my website. So that's it for shop update stuff. Blather. So this past weekend on Friday, my daughter, my husband, and I, which I might have been able to do an intro with the video for that because she was so cute, we went and we picked up pumpkins because, my goodness, the kid loves fall. She got that totally from me. I mean, her dad and I both love fall. My husband, he loves it too, but I am like obsessed. It is my favorite time of the year, not just because I'm a knitter, but because there's Halloween, there's pumpkin pie, there's apple cider, there's like everything good on the earth happens in fall. I don't share a love of pumpkin spice lattes. I'm personally a salted caramel girl myself, but yeah, she was so cute. So we went and we got some pumpkins for the front porch, and she's just been... She really is excited about Halloween because she's 3.5. So she really understands the concept of you walk up to a door, you press the doorbell, and you get things. You get candy. So I think she's fallen in love with the idea that I get to go and get all the candy that I can fit into a bag. Unfortunately, we live on a main street, so we're going to have to go to either my in-laws' neighborhood or we're going to go to my parents' because they have way more houses. It's safer than walking on a street with a 3-year-old who's rambunctious and excited, and I don't want her to run out and get hit by a car, of course. So I think we're going to go to a different neighborhood. I mean, literally this weekend, we just stayed in and we watched movies and I dyed yarn. We watched football. I do fantasy football. Surprise. I killed in one of my leagues because we did a regular league and we did an auction draft league. And I would have played two different players. I would have won in the one I lost in. I was like kicking myself. And for those of you who do fantasy, I don't know how many of you do fantasy football, but I was so disappointed. I hate looking at my lineup and knowing that if I would have just left it the way it was, I would have won. But of course I fiddled with it and I lost. So sad. The last blather thing that I want to talk about is Heather and I, Heather from the Knot House in Frederick, Maryland, and I have been talking about doing another trunk show, which went really well, my first one. So I will be doing a trunk show on December 10th at the Knot House again. And this time we will have all new bases, all new colorways. You know, it'll be a ridiculous amount of fun because I love her and her mom are like a blast to hang out with. So I'm really excited about that. So if you haven't marked it on your calendar, mark it on your calendar. If you're near the Frederick, Maryland area, please, please, please swing by. Say hi. You don't have to buy anything. I'd appreciate it if you did, but you don't have to. I just like seeing you guys out in the real world and talking, knitting, and everything exciting about that. So with that being said, I think that is the end of the show. Thank you so much for tuning in. If you like the podcast and want to know when more episodes are going to be uploaded, please subscribe. Please comment below if you have any questions or you want to just talk about the podcast with me. Feel free to join the Wool and Wardrobe podcast page on Ravelry where you can ask me anything. You can find out about all the knit-alongs, all the information. Same with the Primrose Yarn Co. page on Ravelry where you can find out all the event information that I'll be vending at. You can find out what's new with Primrose Yarn Co. And everything exciting about the knitting world. I think that's everything I have to say to you guys, and happy knitting for the rest of the week. See you guys soon. Bye.